The item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 23195 in the name of Claire Baker on the impact of COVID-19 on Scotland's music and music industry. This debate will be concluded without any question being put. Would those members who wish to speak in this debate please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Claire Baker to open the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would first like to thank all the MSPs who have supported the motion and helped for this evening's debate, and my thanks to the CPG on Music and Tom Arthur MSP for assisting with drafting the motion. Presiding Officer, November 2019 was my Super November. I went to 5 gigs that month. I was in the Hydro, the Usher Hall, Bell Angel and the Carnegie Hall in Dunfermline. I saw artists on international tours in full venues and still managed to go campaigning the next day in a general election. But here we are a year later, and all these venues and others across Scotland are sitting quiet and have been for months. All musicians have no live audiences, all the crew, who often make a living working on different tours, are all out of work. All the promoters, all the technical support, all the venue staff have seen their industry decimated and are facing a long road back to recovery. The COVID-19 pandemic has had a huge impact on everyone working in the music sector. We must not underestimate the value of the sector, and we need to recognise the breadth of livelihoods it supports. During lockdown, so many people turned to the arts to get us through this. Music was a motivator, a comforter, and an entertainer for so many people. Before the pandemic, the music industry across the UK was worth £5.2 billion to the economy, with the live music sector breaking the £1 billion barrier for the first time. The UK are global leaders in producing content, and our music is listened to around the world. In 2019, Scotland welcomed 1.3 million music tourists, and music tourism alone supported almost 5,000 jobs. Coronavirus, the lockdown and the restrictions has brought this all crashing down. The ability of people to perform and earn income has been severely limited. Opportunities for recording, rehearsing, teaching, collaborating have all been restricted. The Musicians Union and the Performing Rights Society have been surveying their members during the pandemic. Although there has been some financial support, 34% of musicians surveyed say they may quit the industry due to the impact of the pandemic, and 65% are facing financial hardship. Musicians' incomes already compare unfavourably to other professions who've invested similar amounts of time and money into their education and training, and receiving only a percentage of income as support has left many facing hardship. There is also clear evidence that too many freelancers have fallen through the cracks. The campaign group Excluded UK have highlighted that 3 million freelancers across the UK, many of them in the cultural sector, are excluded from any support packages. The UK government needs to change this and provide support for all self-employed, and the Scottish government needs to provide as much support as possible through the hardship schemes. The Culture Organisations and Venues Recovery Fund awards were announced last week, and they did benefit some medium-sized music venues. But we need to recognise the grassroots music venues that continue to be at risk. The Music Venue Trust have announced a red list of venues at risk of imminent closure. Backstage at the Green in Kinross is in my region, and it's on the list, along with venues in Inverness and Ayr. The support from the Grassroots Music Venue Stabilisation Fund was only intended to last until October this year. Music venues are listed as an eligible business for the temporary closure grant from Tier 3 and the Business Restrictions Grant, but with no trade and bills mounting up, for many this will only cover a third of their overheads. Other music businesses, such as recording studios or rehearsal rooms, are excluded from the strategic framework funds, even though the restrictions impact heavily on their businesses and many are facing insolvency. We need to see the list of eligible businesses expanded or provide flexibility for local authorities to make awards which reflect their local economy. Last week, the Welsh Government announced an additional £10.7 million for culture recovery, with increased support for freelancers. We do need to see more resources coming forward in Scotland. It is worth noting that while the investment of £107 million into the arts was significant, almost all the funding streams were oversubscribed, and the application windows were often extremely short. There is still £6 million left to allocate, and there are additional consequentials coming to Scotland. These must provide relief for the music sector, which is still facing a crisis situation. But we also need to consider how to generate some income and provide opportunities for performance. Indoor small seated events can take place in tier 0 and 1 with restrictions, and guidance has now been published. In response to my question a few weeks ago, the government said they had paused the pilot events programme. Scotland's Events Recovery Fund has now been launched with £2.75 million, and it needs to be clear if this will support live music events and whether it will support pilots. Although venues can open, the restrictions will make the majority unviable, and support needs to be there to test the safest way to operate, and Scotland could all benefit from lessons we can learn in the Tier 1 areas. There are calls for greater ambition. In the summer, the Art Council of Northern Ireland published In the Bubble of Our Making, Reopening the Arts in Northern Ireland. It's a fairly comprehensive document that looks at removing barriers and encourages innovative ways to perform. Jeff Ellis of DF Concerts has recently produced a report, The Art of the Possible. Live entertainment is not a business that can be easily turned off and on. The planning involved in a tour from booking the flights to the articulated lorries is significant. If we are to see a return to live music at some point, planning needs to start now, and issues over insurance, physical distancing and audience testing need to be explored. The industry needs support to provide a pathway and a roadway back to performances. I have previously asked about the ban on background music and welcome there's an expert group. But there has to be swift progress. There is already evidence that a lower specified decibel does not cause people to raise their voices and does not cause aerosol transmission. Lifting the ban would support the hospitality sector, as well as those in the music sector who benefit from copyright returns. There will be other issues that MSPs wish to raise, but I will end by highlighting music tuition. The next generation of musicians and composers are at risk of losing valuable time and opportunity. The Incorporated Society of Musicians have raised the issue with me, and I agree that music education tutors and pupils would benefit from a consistent approach that supports their studies and that clarity over what can be provided in school and in private tuition is important. Presiding officer, music is a sector that closed first and will likely be the last to return. Scotland's music sector and all who work in it are still in a very vulnerable place, and we need support for the here and now and strong investment for the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's a high level of interest in this debate. We're now into double figures. So can I invite Clare Baker to move a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes?
I move. Thank
you very much. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you very much. We now move to the open debate, and I call Clare Adamson to be followed by Gordon Lyndhurst.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Now, can I thank Clare Baker for securing this debate this evening, and also Tom Arthur and the work of the cross-party group in music in their support for this industry. As someone who, as convener of the Education and Skills Committee, a report into music tuition really highlighted what music brings to us, which is not about a number on a balance sheet. It's about the reaction, the well-being that it brings to people, the joy of working and being with people and performing with them. It is almost unmeasurable in what it means to us as human beings and in our interactions. And for me, that means either taking part in a little session of folk musicians in my local pub, indeed going to see Miss McNeil, who's in the chamber, her band playing in my local pub as well, right through to the big venue events such as Celtic Connections and the other festivals that we know about in Scotland. And I know there's a lot of interest in tonight, so I really want to highlight just one area very quickly, and in doing so to highlight one of Scotland's up-and-coming best folk performers, Iona Fife. Clare, I was reminiscing about what we would normally be doing at this time of year. Last year, I was absolutely delighted to speak at the first Scots Language Awards, and Iona Fife and David Byrne from Malinke provided the music for that evening. It was an absolutely fantastic experience. But that was actually Iona's first appearance after a long time recovering from major surgery in a knee following a fall. And her plight highlights, I think, the precarious nature of some of her musicians and the impact that that has had on her, because she wasn't able to work for 6 months before COVID hit, and that was her first experience, and then it almost immediately went into a situation where she was unable to work again. What this meant was that her earnings didn't reflect the potential of her earnings under normal circumstances, so in accessing any of the support and grants that were there, it was very, very difficult for her to do that and achieve any kind of support that would normally have been there for her had she been performing throughout that time. And I think that precarious nature of the employment in the music industry and in some of the venues and some of the people who are doing it highlights just how difficult it is. And I think the Fair Work Agenda of the Scottish Government has gone a great way in trying to do away with things like unpaid shifts for young people and ensuring that we want to move away from 0 hours contracts and all the rest of it. And the music industry, unfortunately, has a lot of these practices there. And I think following COVID, if anything, if we really value music in our lives, we have to look at some of these longer term problems in our employment arrangements, where it means that people can be very badly underpaid for what they do, or indeed be asked to perform for free, all of these things that we know about. And in doing so, also look at the fact that they're not rewarded for the licences properly in streaming systems to actually represent what they bring. And I think the Musicians Union have highlighted it: 47% of musicians forced to look for other work, 70% unable to take more than a quarter of their usual work, and 36% with no income from music whatsoever. And tuition is a huge part of that. So thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call Gordon Lyndhurst to be followed by Joan McAlpine.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The importance of Scotland's musicians and music industry is indeed beyond doubt. That is a truth borne out by Arthur O'Shaughnessy's poem, Ode, parts of which have become sadly very true in the current restricted circumstances our music makers find themselves in. And I quote from the first verse of that poem. We are the music makers and we are the dreamers of dreams, wandering by lone sea breakers and sitting by desolate streams, world losers and world forsakers on whom the pale moon gleams. From the music which frames and reinforces our traditions, through many of the artists Scotland has produced in recent times, and indeed the events and music we are able to enjoy normally every day, these form a key part of Scotland's social fabric. So it is deeply troubling that these last months have seen such a decline, not only in the opportunities for musicians to produce and perform, but also for the Scottish public to be able to experience and enjoy it. The figures which accompany this narrative emphasise, if emphasis were needed, the problem, and they are deeply troubling. Dramatic falls in income, as set out in figures up to 65%, saying they're facing financial hardship, for example, tell the tale of a sector that has needed but wanted for support from the outset of the current pandemic. The urgency of the issue for the health of the economy in general is but one of the many considerations when it comes to this topic. More so, the effect on individuals, whether the creative musicians themselves or their hearers. Current circumstances follow hard upon the recent flowering of Scottish music. Between 2017 and 2018, Scotland saw a 38% rise in those travelling here for our music, a sector which had become worth over £430 million to the economy and supporting over 4,000 jobs. Figures, of course, only tell one side of the tale, for it is the impact on people which is always most important. Music is critical to the employment, prosperity, and well-being of people across our tourist and hospitality sector, as well as Scottish residents themselves. Venues and industry bodies here in Edinburgh have expressed a combination of exasperation and sadness at continued and, sadly, potentially worse, permanent closure. A live music performance is, of course, only one part of this. Recorded music has faced many general challenges in recent times prior to this year. The ways it is purchased and listened to has been changing in the long term, causing potential harm to revenue generation and returns. Coupled with the restrictions we now have associated to the continued lockdown type conditions we're experiencing have affected music still more, preventing as they have a variety of public venues from playing music. This has hit returns from copyright severely, and the question arises as to the sense in continuing such a restriction. For music is not just entertainment, and we need to recognise that even in these times. For as O'Shaughnessy recognised as he concluded the first verse of his poem I opened with, and I close with this, and he speaks as a music maker, yet we are the movers and shakers of the world forever it seems. So let us ensure that in Scotland, those movers and shakers for the good of our nation may continue to do so.
Thank you very much. I call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I would also like to congratulate Claire Baker on securing this debate and Tom Arthur and the Cross-Party Group on Music for supporting it. I am very well aware of the terrible toll that the pandemic has taken on the music industry and would draw members' attention to the evidence gathered by the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs Committee's inquiry into the effect of COVID on culture and tourism. However, today I wanted to speak initially from a personal perspective, more precisely through the experience of my daughter, Eleanor, who is a 23-year-old musician. She graduated 2 years ago with a first-class degree in actor musicianship, and her career got off to a good start. Last year, she was the on-stage musician at the Lyceum and Citizens Theatre production of Duchess of Malfi. She's also a singer-songwriter with her own band, and at the time of the pandemic, when it broke out, was living in Glasgow and had a number of income streams to support our art. She had a number of residencies in Glasgow music venues, playing blues and rock. She taught young musicians at the weekend at a rock school. And to top that up, like many young musicians, she worked in hospitality in a coffee bar during the day. With lockdown, all that disappeared literally overnight. And of course, it's never come back. And her experience is so typical. Eleanor was more fortunate than some in that her employer furloughed her, and she does have the safety net of family, but like many young people, she's fiercely independent and wants to make her own way in the world. But for many of her musicians' friends, whose income came from playing 5 or 6 nights a week, there was no furlough. And that's why emergency funds for self-employed people are so important. And I would support Claire Baker's comments on the need for the UK government to do more to help freelancers who miss out. I do know that Creative Scotland's Creative Freelancers Hardship Fund has helped a number of musicians, and they have reported back that it's actually very easy to access. But of course, it is oversubscribed. It opened again, and I would encourage government to ensure that everyone who does need the help gets the help. And I also welcome the awards to grassroots music venues. We've taken a lot of evidence on the challenges that they face in the committee, and I understand, as Claire Baker has said, that some say they will still have to close. But it's more than simply a lack of income. It takes years of practice and hard work to be able to play to a professional standard. So having that taken away overnight is a really bitter blow. And performers often draw their mental energy from playing to an audience, so the impact on their mental health is significant. Excuse me. There are some great examples of self-help. I would urge members interested in this matter to go to The Next Stage, a social media platform started in Scotland where musicians are interviewed about their experience of the pandemic and then play sets outdoors. Excuse me. With professional standard recording equipment and filming equipment. They have their own crowdfunder too, and you can find them on Facebook and Instagram. It's often said, Presiding Officer, that the pandemic would have been unbearable if it had happened 25 years ago, before the internet was able to connect us. But for musicians, the internet also has a downside. Back in the 1980s and 1990s, many musicians made money from record sales, and live gigs were really used to publicise the record. Now that model is turned on its head, and most musicians, even quite successful musicians, are, not to put too fine a point of it, ripped off by global streaming and downloading. One example was posted on social media this summer by the acclaimed traditional folk musician Steve Byrne. He co-wrote Malinke's song Pad the Road with Me. It was downloaded 17,737 times on Spotify. For this, Steve was paid the handsome sum of £2.09. This is why I refuse to use streaming services. iTunes is only marginally better. The artists get 10% of the sale. Back in 2008, a CD single sold for £3.99. So the songwriter could expect to receive 12% of that. So in that example, Steve Byrne's case, he might have got around £8,000. Not a fortune, but a great deal better than £2.09. Presiding officer, this parliament does not have any control over big tech, but it's time that those who do tackle this exploitation of musicians. Our lockdown would be unbearable without music and musicians. They might not be classified as essential workers, but the work of musicians is hugely important to the well-being of us all. So I very much back the calls for continued support from government, and once again congratulate and thank Clare Baker for securing this debate.
Thank you, Pauline McNeill, to be followed by Tom Arthur.
Thank you to Clare Baker for securing this important debate, and to Tom Arthur, who I know is going to speak next, for the work he does in the cross-party group on music. Glasgow, my own city, has represented its fair share of successful bands: Primal Scream, Simple Minds, Biffy Clyro, Belle and Sebastian. It's always hard to choose the ones you're going to mention. So they've grown out of an energetic music scene and many small live bands and venues. As Claire Adams has already mentioned, I declare that I gig with the band McFour and have been gigging in Glasgow in the west of Scotland for the last 4 years, which is taking quite a bit of my energy. But Claire will agree with me on this. The communities which we, Girdwoods and your local patch, the Village Inn in East Kilbride, the most vibrant things for communities, and they bring communities together, and so many local musicians have benefited from being able to play. We do play for the love of our music, but we miss it so much. And I know that many musicians across the country also miss so much playing to live audiences. But we know tens of thousands of bands make a living or supplement their income by playing weddings and functions. I see my own city every weekend that I play, so absolutely buzzing with live audiences. And we know that people come from all over the country to come and hear music. Yesterday, I spoke with Dale Cotton, who is the owner of Hire a Band, and he said, in some ways, it would have been easier for the function sector just to have been told to put off events until next April, rather than the kind of drip feed of changes to restrictions. But it's good to say that in hindsight. But I just want to say it's been hard for those bands in the wedding sector, because some of them do make their living from it, and some supplement their living too. Joan McAlpin, in an excellent speech, talks about her daughter, and I just want to say my heart goes out to the young musicians and those musicians who are trying to learn a musical instrument who have been deprived to be able to learn, because music doesn't seem to have a great priority in schools. And a nation that's so characterised by its love for music is one thing I hope this debate will bring out in terms of our recovery. So the wedding and function band sector puts millions of pounds into the pockets of musicians, and that's traditional musicians too, and they've suffered huge pain over the last 9 months. But it's not just the musicians, as Clare Baker talks about, it's the roadies, the lighting engineers, sound engineers, PA companies and promoters, and our music sector is currently on its knees. The vast majority of musicians make self-employed and employed work, and therefore they have been amongst the most badly hit by the pandemic. Musicians' earnings tend to be extremely low in relation to the level of skill that they possess. They are highly skilled, but not highly paid. And during the current crisis, over a third of UK musicians are thinking about leaving the sector. 41% have not received any government support through the pandemic. And I'd like to ask the Cabinet Secretary Summer why she thinks this is the case. To me, it's totally unacceptable in a country that's supposed to value its musicians. I also think At some point, there should be an audit done of the different types of funding that has been available. While some have done very well, others have really done not well at all, but have the same needs. And there's quite a wide variation in the grants that have been received. Grassroots Music Venue Stabilisation Fund, which was announced in July, it was due to help to meet the cost for small venues until the end of October. And I think given today's events, I'd like the government to consider whether that fund should be extended to March 2021 to help keep small venues afloat. As Clare Baker has already said, Jeff Ellis has been working hard behind the scenes to put forward some constructive suggestions regarding how we might get the live music sector seen running again in the UK under the banner of Live Nation. For example, testing audiences before events. Realistically, things will not probably be able to get back fully to normal until there is the distribution of a vaccine. However, we must plan for the stages that follow the rollout of a vaccine. Scotland needs to get back to major events by next summer with corresponding increase in tourism and hospitality, and it goes with it a major economic boost to our own towns and cities. In Glasgow, there are plans to look ahead and where there might be an exit strategy next year under the banner of Back to Live. And these are plans based on reducing capacity, and those of the industry are simply looking for government to be open-minded about it. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, music is part of the character of our nation, and as we manage our way out of this tragic pandemic, we need a properly worked out recovery plan for live music and the associated industries. I don't believe we're anywhere near that now, but I hope this debate will spark going forward how we can have that recovery. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Tom Arthur to be followed by Andy Wagner.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I remind members that I am a member of the Musicians' Union and of my previous work in music. I would like to begin by sincerely thanking Clare Baker for securing this debate so that we're able to have it this side of Christmas. And I also want to thank colleagues in the cross-party group in music for their work in preparing this motion, in particular our Secretariat, David Francis, who coordinated the drafting of the motion to ensure as many views as possible were captured in it. When I was sort of working full-time in music out on the road 120 days, 130 nights a year, I never thought I would ever have the privilege of being a member of the Scottish Parliament. And when I became a candidate and when I was elected, I always promised myself that I would ensure that I made time to be a voice for musicians. And speaking to colleagues and speaking to friends, I really feel for them. So I made a decision that I would use the time I have this evening in this debate not to share my views, but to let musicians speak for themselves, many of whom I know, some I don't. I put out a call on social media yesterday and asked for them to submit their views, and I would try to share as many of them directly in the chamber as possible. So I'll proceed, but these are not my words. These are the words of musicians in Scotland right now. My music career is basically on hold until the vaccine has been distributed. Luckily, I picked up a delivery driver job after seeing a notice in a window, which basically saved me as it allowed me to be able to pay for my monthly bills. Scotland relies on tourism and destination weddings to create jobs and wealth. How will that be affected if there are no hotels, no entertainers, and no tech crew? The lockdown on music affects musicians, DJs, event staff, not only financially, but also mentally. Not only the people who work at these events, but the people who attend and live for their families and friends and family get-togethers. They have nothing to look forward to, as if there's no end game here. In terms of providing a challenging and rewarding environment where bands can hone their skills and go on to achieve wonderful results and no small amount of international recognition, Scotland punches far above its weight. The visible side, the most obviously successful side of this, is rightly lauded, but the grassroots side, but always allowed these acts to grow into what they became, is always taken for granted, and now it's suffering and a very real danger of being permanently diminished. We personally and our whole industry are at crisis point. This year has been a nightmare. The vast majority of musicians' income these days comes from live touring, since streaming fees are nominal and online merch sales are not enough to live on. The majority of our friends in the industry are facing significant financial trouble. Many are facing bankruptcy. Many have families to support. The impact of having our industry ripped out from underneath us is impacting our mental health too. So many people who work in live music are extremely depressed. Everyone is scared for their future. My freelance friends and colleagues, of whom all the Scottish orchestras depend, are in a terrible situation, and I am very aware of the widening gap in circumstances between them having little or no income, a situation that will not improve anytime soon. I haven't gigged since March. I was lucky I had 3 years of accounts, so the self-employment support scheme payments have helped me a bit. It's a serious kick in the teeth to every musician that has spent their teenage years learning and perfecting their instrument and providing night-on-night entertainment to the citizens of our society, keeping them upbeat, laughing, giving people something to look forward to, a place to go for the evening. I have lost nearly £121,000 in fees and am now firing through my own savings that are running really low due to it. And I feel annoyed, as that money was for my kids' future and to go towards their further education. The total inability of the opportunity to make music is driving young freelance professional artists into really challenging positions for mental health and their future in their profession. That was about 500 words of over 5,000 that I received in the space of 12 hours, and many more are still coming in. And I will look for opportunities to share that in future debates and by other media. But I'm very grateful for members for listening to that, and I hope all members will reflect on that. I know the Cabinet Secretary is deeply committed to the music sector, and I encourage the Scottish Government and I encourage the UK Government to continue to strain every sinew and to look at every possibility to ensure that we provide the maximum support for all of the musicians in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Andy Whiteman, to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. And I also want to thank Clare Baker for bringing this debate and Tom Arthur for his support. I've very much enjoyed my time in the cross-party group on music. The importance of this debate, of course, is in highlighting the impact that COVID-19's had on musicians in the music industry. I also want to thank my daughter, who's a professional traditional musician, who is a young person embarking in a musical career, shared her thoughts and experiences with me, because, of course, young people face particular challenges in embarking on a musical career, maybe fresh out of college, and there are no opportunities currently available. Music is language. It's a universal language spoken by everyone. It's the means by which we all, by and large, experience the world through the songs of childhood, the music we play and listen to, and the hymns we sing. And for musicians, of course, music is all that and more. And as others have said, the months of the pandemic have highlighted the importance of music in our lives. Stuck at home during lockdown, many of us turned to the arts to sustain ourselves. We listened to music that was created by professional musicians. We watched films whose soundtracks were created by professional musicians. But during these past few months, musicians have faced massive challenges, most particularly in the lack of financial support. And as others have said, according to the Musicians Union, a third of professional musicians did not qualify for any government support. 34% are considering abandoning the industry completely due to financial hardship, while 47% have already been forced to seek work outside the industry. Most musicians have a portfolio career. One musician will often be a performer, a composer, a teacher, a community music practitioner, a music therapist, a recording engineer, a session musician, as well as many other things as well. But without live work, some musicians, many musicians, most musicians indeed, have been able to support themselves financially only by turning to another aspect of their portfolio career, if they have it. But many, many musicians have experienced every single aspect of their career being lost. And so for musicians, of course, music is work. It's their day job. It's their livelihood, contrary to what some politicians might indicate. It's their identity. It's who they are. It supports their well-being. And we must realise that without more financial support for musicians, we're facing a very real crisis in the music industry, a crisis that may reduce it to by a third or more. And the effects of this will be felt not just by musicians themselves, but by all of us. Every aspect of the music industry needs support. If one falls, the rest falls. For example, without venues, there are no jobs for sound and light technicians. Without technicians, there's no jobs for performing musicians. Without musicians, there's no jobs for recording engineers, and so on. And particularly live streaming needs fixed. The pandemic has brought the serious flaws in the music industry into sharp relief. It's shown that musicians are sustained primarily by income generated by the live side of music business, and that streaming royalties are hugely insufficient. And I therefore welcome the inquiry into the economics of streaming launched by the Digital Culture, Media and Sports Select Committee in the House of Commons. Presiding Officer, thank you to all those who are supporting the music industry at the moment. Thank you to everyone who's been campaigning for better support for musicians. Thank you, for example, for Back to Bandcamp, for supporting musicians by holding Bandcamp Fridays every month, whereby all music spent that day on purchasing musicians' albums goes directly to the musician. Thank you to the musicians who've helped us through lockdown with their live stream concerts. Thank you to the music teachers who've speedily made themselves technically adept in delivering online music tuition. And as presiding officer, we come to the end of a very difficult year, as we face indeed many more difficult months to come. Many of us are holding on to certain things to sustain ourselves: family, friends, our communities, exercise, and the arts and music most particularly. Because without more support for musicians, we risk losing much of the rich musical culture of Scotland. Yet another loss in a year already characterised by far too much loss. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Alistair Allen to be followed by Neil Findlay.
Presiding Officer, I would firstly like to thank Clare Baker for bringing forward today's debate on an important issue which had perhaps not had the attention it deserves until now. At the outset, I would like to declare an interest of a kind, as I am a currently not very active tenor in Back Gaelic Choir. Scotland has a distinctive and diverse musical scene, and not altogether surprisingly, I believe nowhere is that truer than in my constituency, the Western Isles. Whether it's traditional music, pipes, singing for worship, music and song are part of the fabric of life in the islands, and those traditions spill over into the band scene too. COVID-19 and the restrictions that have had to accompany it have had, as others have said, a huge impact on music and on the music industry. Festivals have ceased, venues are struggling, musicians are quitting the industry, music production and events companies are seeing demand for business staples like weddings, for films, PA hire, studio recording, live performances, all drying up and, crucially, all doing so at the same time. In terms of large-scale events, the Royal National Mod, the highlight of any Gael's year, had to move online only. The Hebridean Celtic Festival in my own constituency, like the Éilean Dorracha Festival in Uist, as well as the Fashion Movement founded in Barra, have also had to move to online-only events. Now, not only is all of this a huge cultural loss, but as others have pointed out, it's also an economic loss too. The Heb Celt Festival, for example, draws in around 18,000 people every year to the islands with a net boost to the local economy of over £2 million. And it's worth focusing too, as others today have done, on how the pandemic has affected music in schools. We are all aware of the benefits brought to young people from taking part in music in terms of creativity and skills. While schools have returned, there is a ban, however, on singing, piping, wind and brass instruments being played in schools. That ban is there for a very understandable reason, but it is worth acknowledging that this is having a real impact on young musicians, as well as on their teachers who can no longer teach face-to-face in schools. Now, teachers are witnessing very promising senior pupils give up playing altogether. I have heard this attributed in part to the video submission method, which tutors are being encouraged to use again for very understandable reasons, because of the fact that it can be complicated and not that appealing perhaps to anyone other than the most dedicated pupils. I don't pretend that there isn't a reason there for these restrictions, but given that COVID is going to be with us for some time, perhaps we do need to think about new ways of bringing these musical activities back into the classroom when it's possible to do so and start planning for that. We must, as others have pointed out, avoid a lost generation of musicians. Presiding Officer, making money as a musician was already tough before the pandemic, but COVID has made it virtually impossible for all but the biggest names. If we look at bands not able to tour or do live performances, that is having dire financial consequences for them, and this does need to be recognised. These consequences are most acute for smaller bands who rely on live events and merchandise for their income much more than they do money from streaming, for all the reasons that Joan McAlpin and Andy Whiteman and others have made clear. For all bands and artists, exposure and getting your name out there is a huge function of playing live. I want to end, Presiding Officer, because I cannot do so without giving a name check to Pete and Diesel, the local phenomenon from the Isle of Lewis. I merely end, Presiding Officer, by saying that I hope that if another Pete and Diesel were to come along right now, they would get the platform to make it. To ensure that we do, we must start planning now about what Scotland does when live music makes its widely longed for and happy return.
Thank you very much. I call Neil Findlay to be followed by Sandra White.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I can thank Claire Baker for bringing forward the debate, and I want to declare an interest as chair of the Labour Trade Union Group, and we work with the Musicians Union. The arts and cultural sector, of course, are one of our greatest assets, and for some people that means the galleries, the ballet, the orchestra, but for others it's karaoke and a tea dance or a jamming session, whatever it is, whatever floats your particular boat, there is, we would all agree, great pleasure and enjoyment and sense of well-being to be derived from watching and listening to talented people singing, dancing, playing music and performing. In many communities, these events take place in the local pub or community hall, social club, community arts or music venue, rather than the Hydro or the Festival Theatre or the Glasgow Concert Hall. Excuse me. It's these small venues that are the lifeblood of the Scottish grassroots music scene. In my region, we have many of these venues, and that is very evident during the Edinburgh Festival, but also other times of the year, places like Dreadnought Rock and Bathgate and Smith's and Sneaky Pete's, miners' welfare clubs, music clubs and bars, bowling clubs, British Legions, all of these other places that where live music and entertainment takes place, and they really are struggling to survive, and they are confused by the inconsistency of the way in which grant awards and funds have been rolled out in different areas, or applying different criteria, local authorities taking different approaches, and very much confused about the mixed messages and different approaches being taken by the governments at all levels from one month to the next. During the summer, I was in Inverness and I was in Hootenannies. Many people will have been in there, usually jumping at the peak of the summer tourist season, but there was a handful of people in and no live music, indeed no music whatsoever. The fact that the place was empty was not surprising, given that the very reason it exists is to provide music and be a music venue. Why would people go if the very reason it exists is not there? And of course, this is having a massive, not just financial impact, but a deeply personal impact on performers and the owners of venues and the people who work there. No bookings means no punters, no punters means no performers, no performance means no income, and no income means bills unpaid, empty fridges and creative minds often in turmoil. Yes, certainly.
Pauline McNeill.
Thanks to Neil Findlay for giving way. I wonder if the member would agree with me that given Scotland's love for music, that we seem to be the only country that have banned background music through the pandemic, and we're still waiting the outcome of an expert group. But my understanding is the people in the expert group are the people who've called for the reversal of the ban in the first place. I wondered if the member would agree that that seems a bit odd and should be calling the government to report on that ASAP.
I mean, I think if actions are being taken that are having such an impact on people, then they have to be based on sound evidence and science, and I think that is the issue that people are querying. The issues that people have raised, of course, are not just confined to the owners of venues. We've got DJs, we've got roadies. This week I've spoken to two sound engineers who I know well. They haven't barely earned a penny since the start of the crisis. Managers, agents, bar staff, door staff, venue owners, the list goes on and on. Whether these are community organisations or independent businesses, and speaking to a number of performers, they really are in a desperate situation. Work has dried up completely almost from day one of the crisis. And you know, people have referred to the numbers seeking to leave the industry or looking to do anything else just to put some money through the door. And I think there's a real fear when furlough ends. This week in my own region, today, we've just heard that West Lothian will move up to a level 4. That appears to be based not on science or evidence, but it does appear to have been a political decision because the evidence doesn't back it up. And these venues will be sitting scratching their heads and saying, how come this decision has been made? Because when we look to the evidence that's presented to make that decision, then it simply doesn't stack up. And that is with me having a cursory glance at the evidence presented. If I'm wrong, I will absolutely take that back. But that looks as though that is the evidence that I've got. It would be an absolute travesty if we saw real grassroots music and arts, which develops organically, often supported and promoted by local venues like this, result in us, our areas becoming cultural deserts where the talents of young people and old people alike become more collateral damage in the COVID crisis.
Thank you. And I call Sandra White to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I also would like to thank Claire Baker and Tom Arthur and the Cross-Party Group in Music for lodging this, I think, very important motion. I think it's to be seen the support it's received throughout, you know, parties, cross-party support, certainly reflects the mood of what is happening out with this building and the music industry. Presiding Officer, I represent one of the most vibrant cities in Scotland with an incredible music scene which was officially recognised as a UNESCO City of Music in 2008. At the time, Scotland was one of only three countries in the world to have this honour. I'm very proud of that. The city is now part of a 47-strong network of cities of music, and up until the effects of the pandemic, showcased more than 130 live performances on any given week, which I believe is more than any other Scottish city. And I don't need to tell anyone here or anyone outside there, but our music scene is world-renowned. It caters for all tastes, from contemporary to classical to country, and of course Celtic. Famous internationally acclaimed Celtic Connections has grown and thrived over the years, but this year it will be like no other, as they have had to adapt. The pandemic has felt throughout, and they've had to, like so many others, adapt to this particular issue. And I do want to thank, and I think Paul McNeill mentioned this, I want to thank Jeff Ellis of DF Concerts for his paper, The Art of Possible, which I believe the Scottish Government has received a copy of, and it's very interesting reading. Also, the report from the Scottish music industry lays bare the devastating effect and impact the virus has had on the industry. And this is a direct quote from them. Music venues have been devastated. Grassroots venues, large and small, from gigs and clubs, are really very close to collapse. Some have been able to access bits of support, but many have not qualified for various support schemes or have been denied funding, including furlough due to technicalities. Even those who have been successful accessing some funding are depleting whatever care reserves they have and are very close to going out of business. It's a very, very worrying time. The situation for music venues is dire. Many will soon, if they had not, had to already lay off staff, stop paying suppliers, and will not be able to pay their overheads. If music venues go out of business, then their salaried staff become unemployed, as we mentioned previously. Contractors have less work, suppliers lose valuable clients, and the value of contribution to the local economy is significantly diminished. Our grassroots music venues, I can name just a few, the Hug and Pint, the Garage, King Tut's, just a few, have been the springboard for so many, many musicians. They provide a platform for up-and-coming musicians. I've certainly sat in the King Tut's in many a Sunday afternoon when my nieces, who have a band of their own, have played, and you could see 20 to 30 young people through King Tut's on a Sunday, playing for the joy of it amongst each other and learning from each other as well. So that they provide this great platform for up-and-coming musicians so that they can showcase their talent. and they can create their creativity. Now, I mentioned about people applying for funding, and I know that many of the grassroots venues apply for Grassroots Music Venue Stabilisation Fund, quite a mouthful, and some were successful. But they are pretty worried. They've told me that if it is not renewed or something doesn't take its place, the industry will not survive. So I just ask the Cabinet Secretary, perhaps she could, summing up, could perhaps mention that. Others have mentioned the fact that it's not just the performers. The impact is also felt in many other parts of the industry, promoters, lighting engineers, sound engineers, roadies, by no means a comprehensive list. It's just a snapshot of the jobs behind the scenes that ensure our live music scene thrives. And I just would wish that we can do something as soon as possible to save these venues and survival for the music industry, not just in my constituency of Glasgow, but also throughout Scotland as well. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on George Adam, who will be the last open debate speaker. George.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I too take this opportunity to thank Clare Baker for bringing this important debate to the Chamber and Tom Arthur for his continued work in the CPG on music. It was interesting listening to Sandra White talking about King Tut's, because if you're from the west coast of Scotland, it's a major venue, and you know, it's part of the mythology of music is the fact that Oasis were found there. The music, I think it was the gentleman McGee, went in and saw Oasis live for the first time and signed them that very night. And then the history of that band then went on from there, you know. So, but that shows you how these venues are extremely important to us. And I wanted to speak in this debate, Presiding Officer, for the exact same reason as I wanted to speak in the recent Culture Committee debate, because I love music and it's an extremely important part of my life. So much so that I'm not like Tom or Pauline. I'm not a musician in any case. I just batter away at my guitar in the house and annoy my wife with it. But it makes me happy. And that's part of the thing with music in general, is the fact that it's how it makes us feel. And during this pandemic, this has been one of the things that musicians have shown us, that how important they are to our mood and how we feel and how we relate to the world. As I've said before, I'm often one for being a West Coast of Scotland male. Don't express my feelings by words. When I can sing three verses of a standard song, why would you possibly say I love you when you can sing three verses of an American classic? You know, so it's really important. But music, musicians and their mythology is a part of the whole thing as well. You know, Robert Johnson, the master bluesman and guitarist, died young and didn't make much money during his time as a musician. He spent his life playing juke joints and street corners with little commercial success. And we're living in a world now where some musicians are obviously even struggling harder to make a living because of the times we're living in now. But there wasn't much documentation of Robert Johnson's life apart from the 29 recorded songs that he made. And his life has become legend, the main one being that he sold his soul to the devil at the crossroads to become a master bluesman guitarist. Now, Presiding Officer, I have been hanging about Paisley Cross for a number of years with my guitar, and I'm still pretty garbage at playing the guitar. So I'm still looking for the devil to sell my soul to do it. But the mythology and the idea that goes through with music becomes an important part of everyone's cultural background, because I only know about Robert Johnson because I hung about a lot of friends when I was a teenager in my 20s who played in bands and played guitars and played blues music. And they taught me about this man that was probably instrumental in what was became popular music and blues, rock and roll. And when you think of it, that man died in 1938, penniless, but died in 1938. And there was me in Paisley knowing about that individual because of the people that that's how much music means to people. And the two major music venues in Paisley are the Old Swan Inn and the Bungalow Bar. And it's the Bungalow Bar in particular, Presiding Officer, I want to talk about. The Bungalow recently received £21,000 as part of the 2.2 million Scottish Government Music Venues Stabilisation Fund. But as we move to level 4 in Paisley, we need to look at what is available for these venues as we move forward, because the bungalow is now a community trust and it's an important part of our town and it's an important part of our town's history. Because, presiding officer, it's in a more modern building now than what it was previously. But previously it was, as I said in the recent debate, Glasgow banned punk music in the 70s. Paisley embraced it to make a bit of money. And part of the reason was the bungalow bar saw this as a way forward. And, you know, I could say, what do the Skids, the Associates, Orange Juice, Roddy Frame, the Buzzcocks, Echo and the Bunnymen and Aztec Camera all have in common? They played the bungalow bar in Paisley. And they obviously mention it every time they talk to anybody because that's one of their major achievements. But what I'm saying here is a venue like that that is hugely important to our local community is a major part of the cultural part of Paisley. And as Neil Finlay said, you know, it's not all about opera and the major chamber orchestras. I think, you know, something as basic as pub bands and pub music are important to those of us that go out and see it. And if we need to look about in the future, presiding officer, how we deal with that, how do we make sure that we still have these venues when we come out the other side of that? Because otherwise it will just become another musical myth and legend.
Thank you very much. I now call on Fiona Hislop to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary.
Can I, first of all, Presiding Officer, thank all the members who have spoken in this debate, sharing passion and pride in music and musicians. To thank Clare Baker for bringing the debate, and also to Tom Arthur for his support, and also for giving voice to musicians. Scotland has a well-deserved reputation for the strength of its music industry. From traditional music to the most modern music makers, such as Nova, the winner of this year's Scottish Album of the Year, Scotland's music is recognised throughout the world. In a way, it is a way for us to show who we are as individuals and as a country and to reflect on our place in the world. We can experience music as a private experience or as a communal one, and few things bring people together like the shared experience of live music. And we're all aware of the devastating impact the pandemic has had on our music industry, particularly live music. Restrictions have undoubtedly saved lives, but it has been hard to bear for fans who cannot see their favourite artists live, and for people who have been unable to meet their friends to make music together. It has been even harder for those who work in the industry. One effect of the pandemic has been to remind us of the vast ecosystem that supports our music industry. Musicians and performers may be the most recognisable people in the industry, but they rely on a host of professionals, such as sound engineers, lighting engineers, road and stage crew, managers and promoters, as well as those who run and work in venues up and down the country, and many more besides. Throughout the pandemic, the Scottish Government has sought to ensure that financial support has been available to people in the music industry. We've ensured that a wide range of music industry roles are eligible for Creative Scotland's hardship for creative freelancers, which is currently open for applications. The budget of the fund was originally £5 million, but I have increased this to £8 million so that as many people as possible are able to receive support. We must do what we can to ensure that people are able to stay in the industry, because once we lose skills and experience, that will be difficult to replace. Yes?
Neil Findlay.
I wonder if she could give some guidance for those who aren't accepted for those funds and where they then look to secure some sort of financial assistance to survive.
So there are many different routes in access, and obviously if some people have received one set of funds, they might not be eligible for another. Clearly, the self-employed UK scheme is welcome that it's back, and obviously back at a better level than it was previously, but that hardship fund, the hardship funds that exist are very wide. I've not had complaints of people not receiving them. If they have had problems, it's likely because they have been received of other funds from other means. We've provided £2.2 million for grassroots music venues, and I hear what people say about the importance of that fund. That's obviously a recognition of their role in nurturing and showcasing artistic talent. The grassroots music venues support provided support for 72 venues throughout Scotland.
Music industry businesses have received support from the Cultural Organisations and Venues Relief Fund and the Performing Arts Venue Relief Fund, as well as through the original Pivotal Enterprise Relief Fund and the Creative Tourism and Hospitality Enterprises Hardship Fund. I have made sure that as many of the different funds that were available for support were available for music venues particularly. And that support has reached individuals, businesses across Scotland in all parts of the music industry. We've also supported youth music and music education through a £3 million youth arts funding package delivered by Creative Scotland. Last week, youth arts organisations, including many youth music organisations, received £1 million from the targeted fund. Recipients included Drake Music Scotland, Fesh Ross, the National Youth Choirs of Scotland and the Scottish Brass Band Association that do so much good work all over Scotland, but also in my constituency in West Lothian. This funding will support these organisations to expand their work. It will provide creative opportunities to young people, but it will also provide work and income for artists and musicians and practitioners generally. The music industry has done whatever it can during the pandemic to maintain some level of activity and to stay in touch with audiences. The Scottish Album of the Year Award took place at the start of November, and both the Nordoff Robbins Scottish Music Awards and the Scots Trad Music Awards will take place virtually. Many artists have streamed performances, but obviously they've stripped back those performances. Others have managed to continue to write and record new music, but we recognise the challenges that are there. We've been able to allow recording studios and practice rooms to open in line with guidance published on the 30th of June. The resilience of the industry is known, but also the vulnerabilities, as we've heard from many contributions as well. And we know the support we've provided cannot replace income lost through the closure of live music. But it is some way and some effort to try and support people to survive through this very difficult period of time. The financial... Claire.
Claire Becker.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary. The funds that the Cabinet Secretary has announced have all been very welcome, but she will recognise, as I said, they have been oversubscribed. And is the Government going to look again at the money that's been provided for the strategic framework, whether greater flexibility can be built into that so that more businesses who are connected to the music industry are able to apply for it? While some of them are able to open, they're just unviable. People aren't using their services, and at the moment there's nothing for them to access.
So it was just over a week ago that we had the indication of additional funding. Obviously, we're going to use the remainder of the funding that we have in the cultural funds to look at what needs topped up or supported. I've been attacked for not spending it all, but I deliberately kept some back because we knew that there'd be oversubscription and we need to address them. But of course, we'll look at the strategic framework funds that are available and identify what support for the is still required for a number of areas, not least events, which obviously musicians themselves also depend on as well. So that is part of what our review of those funds will do. The one thing we also need to do and that will help the industry most is to look at recovery and what that might look at, how we're able to open for artists so they can perform. We know that the strategic framework allows music venues to open in level zero and level one. We've obviously got to be careful, particularly at this stage. We've produced guidance that restricts indoor venues to a maximum of 100 people in a seated area, and some venues in level one areas are making plans to open, which obviously will be of great interest, and we're keen to see how those concerts go. But also we need to identify how we can provide a route back, and that's why the Scotland's Events Recovery Fund, which opened on the 2nd November, administered by Events Scotland, is looking about how we can restart the events sector as restrictions are eased. And it addresses the point that those initial events may not be viable in terms of financial position, in terms of the revenue they receive, but support to allow them to happen can help identify a route back. So the communities and the public will regain confidence in hosting and attending events. The grants of up to £35,000 are available, so I would ask people to help publicise that fund as well. Live music is also represented on the Independent Events Industry Advisory Group, which has been looking on a longer-term plan for the return of live events, including live music, and that is a very constructive approach as well. So, Presiding Officer, you know, there's much to do. There's been a great deal of concern raised in this debate, and that is understood. But the job of government has been, right back from the very beginning when Creative Scotland produced the first freelancer hardship funds, which to make sure that we took action, made an impact and helped music venues and musicians survive. Of course, the pandemic has forced much of Scotland's music to fall silent, but the voices in this Parliament has made sure that the needs of music have been heard. I appreciate the sacrifices that many of our musicians are making at this time, but, Presiding Officer, music is a central part of Scotland's life. We recognise that and the support we've provided, and I'm determined to ensure that the voices of those musicians, the music that they play, will be heard throughout the venues in Scotland, and that we will come through this with a vibrant music scene. And I thank everybody for their passion, as I said, and their pride in our musicians, but some of us have to put that policy into practice, and that is what I have been doing as Culture Secretary in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.